Hoş geldiniz. Boğaziçi Üniversitesi Biyomedikal Mühendisliği Enstitüsü'nün Yaşam Bilimleri Teknolojileri Uygulama ve Araştırma Merkezi ve İSEK desteğiyle sürdürdüğü seminer serisi. Akademik ve girişimcileri bir araya getiren seminer serimiz her salı 13'te devam ediyor. Bugün bir akademik değerli konuşmacımız var. İngilizce yapacağız seminerleri. Onun için İngilizce'ye geçiyorum. Thank you for all coming. This weekly Tuesday seminars, we have a very distinguished guest, this time not far from us, from electrical engineering. From Şenol Mutlu will talk about wireless power transfers to battery-less microsystem with a focus on biomedical application. Şenol Mutlu received his undergrad degree in electrical engineering from University of Southern California in Los Angeles in 2000. Later continued with master's and PhD degrees, both in electrical engineering from the University of Michigan Ann Arbor in 2002 and 2005. He is working since that at Department of Electrical Electronics Engineering at Oran Boğaziçi University. His research work is on MEMS systems, microsystem based development and design, energy harvesting, microfluidics, organic electronics, various forms of very active research lab he's been keeping up. He's been very busy. He was kind enough to give us a seminar this week for us. I hope it will be very interesting for all the participants that are watching us live or later in our YouTube channel. Thank you, Professor Mutlu, Şenol Hocam. Thanks for coming. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Cengizhan Hoca. Thank you very much for the introduction. And thank you very much for inviting me here. I'm hoping to enjoy this talk as well, because it's really relevant to biomedical engineering as well. And basically, this work I have been doing for the last 16 years at Boğaziçi University. And actually, it's getting all together. So I really like what we have come so far, and we have certain experience. And with our knowledge and with our experience, I think we can apply this to many other biomedical engineering applications. So that's why I'm hoping to get good feedback from you as well. Later on, we can get in touch and talk about possible applications as well. Okay, so let me start. The talk is about wireless power transfer to battery-less microsystem. So basically, this microsystem is implanted inside the body, and we're retrieving small information from sensors. Or actually, recently I have also an actuator example. I'll also share with that. Okay, so I'll start with a very nice example, successful RF power transfer, wireless RF power transfer. CardioMEMS. In MEMS field, it's very famous, and I'll talk about this story, and it's a good start, okay? So, but it uses RF power transfer. So, but recently, in the last 10 years, the focus was on ultrasonic methods and optical methods to send power wirelessly to these kind of implanted microsystems. I'll get to that. Of course, I'm talking mostly about active systems. When I say active system, there is an integrated circuit, application-specific integrated circuit associated with that. We're talking about sending power to that chip, integrated circuit chip, and then reading sensors information from there, or maybe actuating something inside, okay? That's why I'm also have a good example, optical power transfer to an actuator inside an MRI machine. And finally, last thing, I'll talk about triboelectric energy harvesting chip we made a system that communicates wirelessly with an RF communication, and I'll conclude. Okay, so as I said, this story, I like the story, what we have come so far, and actually this word from Nikola Tesla summarizes it very well. Okay, so if you want to find the secrets of the universe, think in terms of energy, frequency, and vibration. Actually, wireless power transfer is all about that. It's all about resonance. It's all about vibrating at the right frequency. If you choose the right frequency, you can send the power. And if you choose the right frequency, you can get information from the sensor. So Nikola Tesla was right basically maybe 120 years ago. And he's still right, okay? So let's start with the CardioMEMS example. So this is basically in MEMS very popular. It's called inductive coupling. So you use LC resonance. So you have an inductor and capacitor. So connected together, it forms a resonance circuit. Okay. So if this is your sensor, as I said, this is your coil connected to a capacitor, you can sense this, the resonance frequency of this LC resonance circuit, which typically uses it as a sensor, externally with another coil. As you can see, they are magnetically coupled. We call this inductive coupling. So in MEMS field around 2000, people started working on this technology. Think about it. So also it's a good entrepreneurship example, I think. So you start in 2000, okay? So after 20 years only, now it's successful, okay? So you can see, you can look at its milestones. Okay, basically I have one here. In 2014, it is sold to St. Jude Medical for almost $500 million. So now Abbott purchased it. And actually it's the first and only FDA approved MEMS system, sensing system, powered by RF energy. And basically, I'll show the examples. It's for heart failure patients, very old people, their heart is failing, and you insert this pressure sensor into the aorta of the people, and you send them to home, not to hospital. And you monitor its this pressure sensor every day wirelessly, and the doctor can basically monitor it from the hospital and looks at whether the heart is really failing or not, okay? So, and of course, because of that, it's designed to last the lifetime of the patient. It stays there, okay? Very small procedure. It involves, as I said, because it's LC method. So look at let's study this, okay? You have a coil here. This coil is really big. I mean, for you, it's not that big, like 15 millimeter. And it is placed here, basically in around this aorta in this region. So this is basically, as I said, you have a capacitor. This is the membrane. The pressure sensor is nothing more than a membrane. Because of the external pressure, it just bends. This capacitance changes. And this capacitor is connected to a fixed inductor, which is shown with L. So LC's resonance frequency changes according to this formula. And externally, with an external coil, you monitor this. And everything is perfect for this example because everything is hermetically sealed. Think about it, it's inside a glass and nothing can go in, nothing can go out, okay? Because of that, it's not harmful to body, okay? And typically it uses 30 megahertz. So this is a magical number, 30 megahertz, around 10 megahertz because this is around this frequencies, the RF electromagnetic radiation can penetrate through the body, okay? So it's a trade-off basically, 10 megahertz, 30 megahertz operating frequency and working distance of a couple centimeter. So actually you can watch it on, you can watch this movies actually. You can see even the real operation the doctors are doing. So under the fluoroscopy, they use catheters and guide wires and basically they choose a good location in here maybe, okay? So using a catheter placed in pulmonary artery. So a place is chosen and then a guide wire is inserted. See, this is the sensor. This is the flapping wings just to secure it into your aorta, okay? And then it is released. See, this is the aorta. It's actually, it occupies some portion of it. It's kind of, because it's hermetically sealed, it's not that bad, okay? So then during the operation actually, because catheter has this balloon pressure sensor inside, so this gives you a very baseline. So for calibration, that catheter during the procedure, basically during the operation procedure, so the catheter goes there, makes a pressure reading. And that pressure reading is your calibration point. It is matched to this reading unit. So it's very important. Otherwise it will not get accurate results, okay? So at the bedside during the operation, this is done, okay? Then the patient leaves the hospital. Basically, he leaves to home, okay? Every day for 18 seconds, you get these wireless measurements from the heart, this pressure measurements, okay? So as you can see, a pillow is given to the patient, and inside this pillow, there is a antenna or coil, okay? And the wireless pressure sensor, another coil here, is here. Basically, these two communicates to each other. As I said, this is a very passive device, but this pressure readings, you get it, and then using Wi-Fi maybe or other methods, it is transferred to the database, and the doctor can monitor this heart level, basically, beating level or the pressure level every day, and the doctor can make a decision. Okay, your heart is going down, come to hospital and get some help. That's the purpose of this kind of system, actually. It's passive pressure sensor, okay? So, but as you can see, there are limitations for to RF power transfer or data transfer, okay? And this is because, so I'm getting this from another talk from Michel Maharvis. He's from UC Berkeley, and we're in touch, and I also follow his research. This is, he's saying, we are bag of salt as human beings, basically. If you're bag of salt, that means you're really conductive, and that means RF radiation cannot penetrate too much into your body, okay? That's why 10 megahertz, it can penetrate longer distances. That's why 10 megahertz, 30 megahertz makes sense. But for 10 megahertz, your antenna size or your coil size can be like centimeter. That's how. That's what the cardioMEMS did, okay? But the idea is, can we lower the size, the overall size below 1 millimeter, okay? That's the whole purpose, like reaching the whole system, fitting to not centimeter, but below 1 millimeter, okay? So that's why your footprint must be around 100 micrometer, very small dimensions, okay? In order to reach this dimension in RF, it has to be tens of gigahertz. You have to use 10 gigahertz, let's say. But as I said, with 10 gigahertz, the body has no penetration depth for that electromagnetic radiation, okay? But this is not true for ultrasonic power, okay? So ultrasonic power doesn't have attenuation, actually. Like this is a good example. 10 gigahertz electromagnetic radiation, 2 millimeter into the brain tissue, you have 20 dB attenuation in power. But look at that here, 2 millimeter into the brain tissue, if you're using acoustic power, that means ultrasonic power at 10 megahertz, you have only 1 dB attenuation. That's very good actual advantage, okay? And also electromagnetic, the regulations, health regulations, output power limit due to safety regulations for electromagnetic, it cannot exceed 10 milliwatt per centimeter square. But look at ultrasonic one, it's 72 times more. So you can pump more power to the body, actually, to power your devices. That's why in the last 10 years, actually ultrasonic, like piezoelectric research, microsystems picked up, and now it's very, now we see very good results of that. Actually, similar to that optical power, you can have a higher power pumping. So I'll come to that, the optical one as well, okay? But I think you get the idea. So the reason for this ultrasonic can help and has less attenuation in body because of the sound wave. Sound wave speed is actually in the human body is like 1500 meter per second, but the speed of light, speed of electromagnetic radiation is, you know, it's 3 × 10^8 meter per second. Because of that difference, actually the ultrasonic waves are not attenuated or in the body, okay? So actually similar to the RF technology, RF methodology, you can do the same thing for ultrasonic ones. All you need is to couple two piezoelectric elements, okay? So actually this is done for neural recording, actually, this has been done. So typically you choose a 1 millimeter cube piezoelectric element like that. You can connect transistor electrode like that, and you can make a neural stimulator or neural recording, okay? And you can power this system externally with another piezoelectric element. This can be basically your ultrasonic probe, okay? And actually this has been done, as I said, it's called, it's 0.8 millimeter cube. It's called neural dust, okay? Developed by Maharvis. The PCB is also done. It is implanted to the, actually it's neural stimulation application has been shown on mouse, like in static nerve. It is implanted and externally using an ultrasound powering, you can see the mouse's leg stitching with the applied commands. Okay, so I also have done important stuff on this, but this is not published. That's why I'm not showing you the results I have done. But I'm just showing like how easy it is to do wireless power transfer with ultrasonic using just two piezo elements here. This is water. So water, unlike air, for ultrasonic sound, it's very good environment. It's a very good medium for ultrasonic waves. Air is not a good medium for ultrasonic waves, of course, but water is not like that. See, this is inside water. Power is pumped through this piezo. This is the picking up piezo. And you can see the LEDs are turning on and off. Okay. And as I said, you can pump maximum 720 milliwatt per centimeter square if you're using this kind of technology. Because it's unpublished, I don't want to talk more on this. But I want to switch to optical power transfer. Okay. This actually mostly for MRI environment, magnetic resonance imaging environment, because there you have, it's a harsh environment for electronics, basically. You have high RF fields, noise. You cannot use long wires because it can cause extra heating, okay? So because you cannot use electrical wires, maybe you can use optical wires. We call them fiber optic cables, okay? So for this kind of applications, basically, we started on this optical power transfer to microsystems. And actually, we don't like batteries. Batteries are toxic and it reduces lifetime. Instead, you can harvest the ambient energy or delivered energy. In this case, using a laser or some other means, you can deliver energy to your microsystem. And actually, the reason for this is shown here, the power density. So, like under the sunlight, under direct sunlight, as you can see, light optical means has the highest power density you can get, okay? Actually with laser, this can be even multiplied a couple of times, okay? If you're deriving power with a laser, okay? The second one is vibration piezoelectric. When we say piezoelectric, that's the ultrasonic one. That's why actually optical and ultrasonic ones are studied now as alternative to RF technologies because they can deliver high power density and we can harvest that the energy, okay? And of course, another thing is we have to also either transmit data and receive data from that tiny microsystem. That's also important. So not only sending power, also receiving data from the system, okay? And this is my novel solution. I came up with this idea in around 2011, okay? So why don't you use a regular LED, light emitting diode, okay? So LED actually at that time, nobody knew that LED can also work as a solar cell. It can also actually harvest energy, optical energy. So LED not only emits light, but it can also work like a photodiode or as a solar cell, okay? So that's the idea, basically send power with a higher energy, with lower wavelength, and this LED can harvest it and can power up the ASIC, your ASIC, basically integrated circuit. So you have to custom design this circuitry, okay? It wakes up, so no batteries, but there can be some storage capacitor here. So it receives the energy, LED receives the energy, it stores it with the help of integrated circuit. It stores it in a storage capacitor. And once you reach the required levels, it can make, let's say, temperature sensor. Like, let's say on board, you have temperature sensor. Digitally, it can read that temperature sensor information. And that temperature sensor information can be sent out using the same LED by maybe glimping, by just maybe turning on and off the LED. This is like digital. On off, by just turning it on and off, this data can be transmitted out to the outside, okay? So this shows basically LEDs, these are my measurements, LEDs can really Actually, it can do better than silicon photodiodes. It can harvest optical energy. And another advantage of LED is that it can generate you higher voltages than silicon. Even though silicon can generate you 0.6 volt, 0.6 volt is not enough to power your integrated circuitry. Okay, but LED can directly give you 1.2 volt, which is enough actually to power your circuitry. And this shows that actually LED can do both, sorry for that, emit light and absorb light. This is just for different wavelengths, I'm just showing that. Okay, and actually what does the integrated circuit do? So this is IV graph of the, I don't want to get too much into the details, but this is the IV curve of the light emitting diode under light, let's say under laser light, okay? So when, of course, there's no power. You shine light, when you shine light, of course, you will be at this point. What your circuitry would do is that it will start to wake up and you will, of course, walk on this graph. Okay, and here, basically, as long as you're on this side, you're harvesting energy. So here, you're harvesting energy and you're storing that on your storage capacitor. You come to here. So at this point, your circuitry wakes up and makes measurements or makes decisions. Okay, so then eventually you have to transmit your data through the same LED. Then from here, you have to move to here. That means by just turning switches on and off, you can do this. You can go from one mode of energy harvesting to light emission, okay? A similar thing for the piezoelectric elements in ultrasonic ones as well. Also in RF transmitters for the coils, it's all similar methods, okay? So I have done this, and just to give you an idea, the important thing is to design this integrated circuitry, okay? Because it does all the trick. But this is very time consuming. So you need 2 years or 3 years of design, and you have to use very complicated design tools. These are really state of the art integrated circuit design tools. Fortunately, we're at a university, we're paying 3,000 euros for that service. But actually, if you're in an industry for 1 year, you have to pay around 140,000 euros for that software to make simulations, to make your design. Okay, similar to that, fabrication cost is a lot. So for you pay 2,000 euros to get 40 of these integrated circuit chips, and lead time typically takes 4 months to fabricate, for them to fabricate these, and you need 1 or 2 months to test them. So it's very time consuming. It's very tedious job, but once you do it, basically all these circuitry, all the transistors, all of them, of course, they are consuming microamps or microwatts. We're talking about 10 microwatts or 100 microwatt region. And each component here maybe consumes 1 microwatt. These are very tiny, okay? Tiny power levels. So state of the art, maybe it consumes 10 nanowatt when it's sleeping. In deep sleep, 10 nanowatt, 100 nanowatt of power when you're sleeping, but when you're doing operation, it consumes 1 microwatt, 10 microwatt, 100 microwatt of levels, okay? So all these system details, of course, I'm not going to bore you with that. But just to show you, as I said, like how can you change from solar energy to the harvesting solar energy to emitting light? It's done with these switches. Switches are nothing more than transistors. Basically, if you have enough energy, you can turn on a switch like that, turn on a transistor basically like that. And you can route the energy from one region to another by just turning on transistors. Transistors here are nothing more than switches. Okay. And actually, I just want to show you, like we put a temperature sensor on board, and that temperature, of course, it's a digital temperature sensor. It has ones and zeros to show you what the temperature on board is. And this is the final result. Basically, this is complete wireless system. So this is in air. So 10 centimeter away, we're using a light source like laser, halogen lamp, or any light source. This system powers up itself, okay? It makes temperature sensor measurements. It turns that temperature information to digital information, and that digital information using the same LED, it is transmitted to the outside. And we have an optical sensor here to pick up that light emission from the LED, okay? And this is the final result. Do you see, basically, because it's digital, three pulses like that, it means preamble. Preamble means I'm starting to send the data. If it's a single burst like that, that means it's logic one. Here is logic one, logic zero, if it is two pulses like that next to each other. Okay, here is again logic zero, logic one, logic one. As you can see, it's very clearly from 10 centimeter distance, you can read this wireless and batteryless microsystems temperature sensor data. It's telling you. It says 110011. Okay, what that means, maybe it means 23 degrees Celsius. Okay, so this is a complete work. So, and I'm proud of it. And as I said, I started this in 2011, but after that time, actually it picked up in other, at other universities as well. So of course, from University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, they made the world's smallest computer with this concept. Look at that, this is a computer actually. On the ASIC I'm talking to you, on that integrated circuit, you can also put a microprocessor. That microprocessor means it's a computer, okay? That computer can be powered up by solar cell or an LED, and its information can be transmitted again using LED. So they have done this actually. So of course, look at the size of this, 400 micron by 400 micrometer, okay? And this can make computation, okay? And this is the one grain of rice. Look at the size of that. And actually on their publication, they put this system, they covered it with a cluster of cancer cells, and they made a wireless temperature measurement. And actually they are saying that, they are claiming that, they found that mitochondria are 10 degrees higher than the other parts of the cells. That's what they claim, because dimensions are so small, they are saying that they can measure parts of the cell itself. And other thing is, as I said, it can be used as a neural stimulator. So this is a similar system, integrated circuit, LED, and this also works like these electrodes can also work like a neural stimulator. So they can be placed on the here, very close to the underneath the skin of a mouse. Okay, and using light, they can be stimulated. You can do neural stimulation or neural recording at the same time. This has been done actually, this has been achieved, and it gives you this small, this size neural recorder. And recently, because of the picking up of optogenetics, actually, now these neural probes, they don't only have electrodes, metal electrodes, they have LEDs. They call it micro LED, okay? They use it to stimulate neural cells. Now, because of the optogenetics, they modify the genetics of the neural cells, they can stimulate the neural cells using light, okay? That's why with this shank, with this neural probe, they can insert to the neural tissue, and they can make lots of, actually they are making in neuroscience, with this method, they discover a lot, I think. It's very helpful tool, because light can individually, without mixing to the other cells, can individually stimulate a neural cell, and using these electrodes around it, you can pick up its response, the response of the neural cell. Instead of electrically stimulating a cell and electrically picking up the cell response, you're optically stimulating neural cell and you're picking up its response using electrical electrodes. So also this is new, also I think this research can go into that direction. Okay, so let me continue. As I said, last I did this work, and I haven't worked on actuator before, like I was working mostly on sensors, because you don't have much power, okay? You don't have much power, so actuators needs a lot of power. And you need these kind of systems inside the MRI. As I said, inside MRI machine, you don't have a precise positioning system. You don't have much space there, and you cannot put lots of robotic systems in there. Even though you put things, basically it has to be non-magnetic and no electrical cables. So because of these procedures, actually, because of these limitations, challenges, developing wireless and batteryless actuators for MRI makes sense, okay? It also makes sense because MRI has a high contrast ratio of soft tissue, non-ionizing radiation. It's really basically interventional MRI has picked up. It's a new field, but because of these limitations, it's not reaching its peak levels. It's not reaching its peak levels. In interventional MRI, what is the problem? Because of these limitations, actually, it's called in and out procedure. So inside the machine, when the patient is inside the machine, in the operating room, you can see its images, all the organs' positions. Okay. So let's say you want to make a simple biopsy procedure. Okay. So, but you need to mark the entry position, let's say. How are you going to do that? So as can be seen here, either the doctor will reach with his hand into the machine and mark it, but see, he's trying to look at the image and also he's trying to make the marking position, mark it for the biopsy. So also it's called in and out procedure because it's very hard to do that. You take images, then the patient goes out and when the patient is outside, you mark the position. These are the limitations, okay? So basically, a robotic system, I think, can solve this kind of problem. So especially, it may help for precise positioning. So of course, there's a need, in MRI machines for like biopsy operations. Of course, there are solutions. These are called tethered robotic solutions. And mostly they are pneumatic or hydraulic. So you can see the systems here. Pneumatic and hydraulic, they suffer from cavitations, fluidic leakage, and they are back drivable. So basically their motions are not precise, especially if it is millimeter or below, their precision are not that accurate. Think about it, and they are not electrically controlled. Okay. Of course, the most favored one is ultrasonic motors. So you can use ultrasonic motors like as shown here. Of course, it's electrically controlled, but the cable wires for ultrasonic motors, you need high frequency electrical signals. That means electrical wires, long electrical wires with high frequency signals. That's not good for MRI machine. So that's why this has to be away from the operation region, this motor, because they will create a MR compatibility problem. And they will block the image, okay? So of course, they can also find solutions, but this ultrasonic one, because it uses electrical wires, still it's a problem, okay? There are untethered robotic solutions, actually. So what they do is they use a steel ball, actually, because you have basically gradient coils. This gradient field coils can move actually steel balls. That was the idea, untethered ones, okay? So let's say you insert steel balls, millimeter size or 10 micron or 100 micron steel balls, and you by applying gradient coils, by applying power to the gradient coils, maybe you can move them, okay? But this, as you can see, this creates large image artifacts. Like if you have a steel ball here, look at that. Look at the artifact it creates around. You cannot see anything, okay? And also you have miniaturization limitations because gradient coils can give you this much field gradient, and this doesn't generate too much power, force and torque you need to make these kind of interventional operations. Okay, so my solution basically use Lorentz force. Why Lorentz force actuation? Because you're taking advantage of B0 field of the MRI machine. B0 field is, think about it, 1.5 Tesla or 3 Tesla. Actually, I use 7 Tesla. You have a 7 Tesla magnetic field and you should take advantage of that, okay? So your torque is multiplied by that, by B0, by multiplied by 7. That's why actually you can generate enough torque inside the MRI machine, okay? So since we're not using wires, electrical wires, so my novel solution is that have a coil and connected to a solar cell as shown here. This solar cell gets the power optically, it turns it into electrical current. And this electrical current flows in your coil and it creates a magnetic field of itself. And this B0 field, basically, this created magnetic moment, we call it mu, tries to align itself with the B0. That's how you get the torque or action. Actually, there is no net force, but always a torque. And the torque, this kind of torque generation, the principle is very simple. You have B0 fixed, B0 field of MRI machine, as I said, 7 Tesla in my case. This 7 Tesla, this direction is fixed. And if you have a coil in that direction, and if you send power current to that coil, it has its own magnetic field, magnetic moment, we call it mu, as shown in red here. This red arrow will try to align itself with this black arrow. That's why it tries to rotate like that. Okay. And I made scaling analysis. Actually, in this dimensions, like millimeter or below, electromagnetic actuators are not scaling favorably. Okay, that's why in MEMS we always have electrostatic actuators, electrostatic. But I have a special environment, and in this environment I have a huge magnet, 7 Tesla. Okay, so it shows that actually if you have a coil size of 2 millimeter by 2 millimeter by 2 millimeter, and you're sending the laser power with laser basically of this much, okay, you're generating a current of 9 milliamp, and this with 9 milliamp you can generate maximum force of 53 millinewton and 100 micronewton per meter torque. Okay, actually this is good enough. In this research I aimed for this part because it's tiny, it's small. Okay, and why do I use this much? Can't I pump more laser power? This is health regulation. So basically, if you look at for a certain wavelength, I use 980 nanometer infrared. If you look at the regulations on skin, basically this application, basically this will be on the surface of the patient, on the skin. The regulations for the skin exposure to optical light, optical power is this much for this wavelength. It changes with wavelength. So that's why you can pump maximum 7.3, around 7 milliwatt per millimeter square of optical power to a patient. Okay, so as you can see, this is according to this scaling, these forces are good enough for 7 Tesla MRI machine. But if you increase the coil size a little bit, it scales very favorably, of course. Look at the numbers. Suddenly you're getting 36 milliamp and the force jumps too much, torque jumps too much. So that's why like my next step is actually to use larger coils to generate really large forces and torques that can be used inside MRI machine. Okay, so basically this is the idea. Basically you need a positioning system on the surface of the patient. Say this is your biopsy needle or a marker. So using this kind of positioning, precise positioning system, these are optical fibers. So no electrical wires, basically. You can do positioning. While the doctor seeing the MRI image with a joystick, he can move this stage and mark the entry of the biopsy needle, for example. Okay. Also, another good thing about this actuator is that, as you can see, this is a free actuator. It's modular. That means you can just get one, paste it or glue it to anywhere, and you can get any type of actuation you want. For example, to a cantilever beam like that, just attach your modular actuator, wireless battery-less actuator like that. You can bend this beam or use 4 of them, and you can make a rotor, like a motor. Okay. Actually, this is novel. I have done this for the first time. Just use 6 of them and you can make the sphere roll. Okay. I'll show you all that. Basically, how do I do it? Most difficulty is that getting non-magnetic electronic components. That's why you have to do everything yourself by hand. So I did this, I cut unpackaged. You need to get unpackaged components, cut them, glue them. So I did all them myself, and also the coils, you basically bind them yourself. This is like millimeter sized coils. Just get a coil, attach a tiny solar cell to that. And look at that. So this is infrared radiation. This is on a magnet. This is not inside MRI machine, on a magnet. See, it's that simple. Okay. It's and the size is like 3 millimeter. This laser spot can actuate it. Okay. So of course I wanted to catch basically calibrate or characterize this actuation. I used an optical fiber beam here. This beam is like 110 micron wide. And it's flexible, it's glass basically. characterize what kind of forces and torque we're getting. It's of course according to the Lorentz force equations. Okay, just to show that, I made a setup like that. So here I'm showing how to bend this optical fiber beam with my actuator. So this light goes through the optical fiber, hits the solar cell and creates a current here. And this current creates a torque. And this core-based torque tries to orient itself with the B0 field of the MRI machine. Okay, so let's see, this is inside 7 Tesla MRI machine and the direction of the 7 Tesla magnetic field is around here. So this is the optical fiber. This is the free optical fiber. So as you can see, as I turn on the optical laser power, a torque is generated like that. And this torque bends this optical fiber beam. Of course, this orientation is important. So look at here, B0, and my coil is oriented like that. This is where you get the maximum torque. So that's why here, this example, you get the largest bending and you get some decent torque. But if your orientation is different, like 45 degrees, you have different values, of course, lower, not the largest torque, but good enough, 22 degrees. And actually this is getting like, this is advantageous positions like with respect to B0. If you place your coil like that, small bending, decent torque, and in the worst case, smallest bending, smallest torque. Like this is the weakest point. If it is like that, of course, you cannot generate any torque. Like if the coil sits 90 degrees like that. I have done example for 45 degrees, okay? But this was a good experiment. Basically, it shows how torque is generated inside MRI and it can bend the beam. And also, we checked this to check MRI compatibility basically, okay? So there was no image effect. So up to here, no laser power. See three different slices. Here, this is my coil actually. It doesn't generate any artifact. This is plastic because it looks black. But if you start pumping laser power, it generates around 7 milliampere. See, look at the artifact. The artifact. Also, again here, this portion, 0 milliamp. 1 milliamp. If you start pumping more optical power, that means more current, electrical current, of course, artifact grows. And some, it may be advantageous for some imaging purposes, this kind of actuation as well. Okay. So here, basically, as I said, it's modular, just get four of these and make a rotor. See, this is rotor rotating. This is the magnet. This is not inside MRI machine. It is sitting on top of a permanent magnet. This was the laser power. So see the distance is like 12 centimeter here actually, but you can actuate this across 1 meter actually. It's just rotating, okay? It's very simple. Just get four actuators, wireless actuators, just stick them around an axis and you build your rotor, okay? And also inside silicon oil, very viscous actually, we showed this wireless operation. This is like viscosity higher than honey actually in these ones. 1000 CST, 1000 CST, 1000 CST, 100 CST. This is like water viscosity. Actually, we can show that wirelessly we can rotate this inside different viscosities of fluid. But rotating this inside MRI machine was really hard because the magnetic field was uniform. I have to make some analysis. Actually, these two, the idea is this basically. If the light is in this side, it rotates in one direction. If the light is on this side, it rotates the other direction. Okay. So at any time, only one or two units, modules, sees the light. But these two doesn't see the light. Actually, they oppose the rotation. So they generate back EMF. They start not to rotate, okay? That's a real big difficulty actually, okay? So that's why I made the analysis here and show this back EMF torque generation. Actually, you're generating energy here, but I don't want this energy. I want to rotate, generate a torque. The other coils are trying to oppose that, okay? But I have shown this basically, this back EMF torque. But actually, inside the MRI, we were able to rotate this. Okay, I used two fibers because I need more optical power. Okay, because I didn't have enough uniformity. As I increase, this is, as I said, infrared light. You can see this in the camera. You can see this light. This optical power means around 40 milliamp on the coils, and you can see them. It's rotating inside 7 Tesla. Okay, and again, it's MRI compatible. It doesn't cause any, as you can see, my actuator doesn't cause any image artifact. Okay, and this is, as I said, this is the most novel thing I have done. I think this is like a toy. So get 6 of these wireless and batteryless modules, put them inside a sphere. So this is power LED. So it emits light in infrared. So that's why you cannot see it. Actually, if you can see in infrared, this should be really ultra bright light actually. Right now there is an ultra bright light here. You don't see it, okay? That's how you send the power to this sphere, and the sphere just starts to rotate. And as I said, this is the permanent magnet. It has to be on top of a permanent magnet, of course, for this to rotate. Yeah. Also, I have shown this to rotate, to roll inside 7 Tesla MRI machine as well, as shown here. Okay. So basically, I'm almost out of time, but I also did triboelectric energy harvesters. Let me talk it in a couple minutes. What is triboelectric energy harvesters? It's nothing more than a balloon and glass rod experiment. What do you do when you rub them across to each other? Rub glass rod to a balloon. You get lots of static charges developed. And actually that can be like 10,000 volts. You're generating 10,000 volts just doing this rubbing. That's the triboelectric energy harvester, okay? Or Van der Graaf generator. By just rubbing, you can generate 10,000 volts, okay? It's 10,000 volts, but there isn't much energy there. So it won't kill you, okay? Similar to that, get two, here, it's called triboelectric series. Get two different materials. Let's say glass here, most positive, and most negative, like Teflon. Just contact them like that and separate them. On the surfaces, you're creating charges, electrical charges. And this separation creates voltage, basically. And behind that charges, if you have collecting electrodes, you can collect that, okay? So that's the end. Actually, you can do it to make wireless keyboards or basically like that. It's that simple. Just two different materials, electrodes, you just press it, and you can turn on an LCD display. There is no wires, there's no battery here, there's no power line here, okay? And actually, in order to improve, so we use PDMS, but PDMS doesn't have the best negativity. So that's why we have to include Teflon molecules there. So we did it at the molecular level. So that's why we prepared nano surfaces. So with Professor Amitav Sanyal from chemistry department, actually we have shown that if you put more and more Teflon molecules on the surfaces, you generate more and more power. Okay, that's what we have done. Actually, you can see, this is the Teflon. This is the one Amitav Hoca produced for us. Okay, a factor of 48 increase in power. So this is regular PDMS, just get a PDMS, but to a PDMS, if you graft or if you functionalize it with fluor molecules, which you make it similar to the Teflon, you get better power ratings, okay? Actually, this is very famous. Basically, once you press a single press on this triboelectric energy harvesters, can light 150 LEDs. Is this too much power? See, this is like a trick. Actually, they are on for maybe only 100 milliseconds. And that's it. And actually, there isn't much power here. What's the power level we're hearing? 200 microwatt. Yeah. You're generating, but with one pressing here. So this is one footstep. You're generating 200 microwatt. And you can use that basically maybe for wearable electronics and for other things. But what did we use it for? We used it to power our RF integrated circuitry because it has a temperature sensor in it. It has an antenna. So the generated power powers up this chip, RF chip, and this temperature sensor is transmitted. Okay, we have shown it. Basically, we fabricated two different chips. These are the power levels of that. Okay, and basically, the difficulty or the novelty here in this research is that, as I said, the powerful side of triboelectric energy harvesters, they can generate huge voltages, like 10,000 volts. Okay, but this is called electromagnetic electrostatic discharge, like EST. EST is really bad for chips, for your integrated circuits. Okay, so you cannot have, you have to limit your energy harvester so that it can give you maximum of 70 volt, let's say. So that's what we did. So we designed our energy harvester so that with one press, it maximum it generates 70 volt. 70 volt is the limit in this, basically in this electronics industry right now for the CMOS technology. It cannot handle any voltages above 70 volt. Of course, we could have wanted to harvest 10,000 volt, but it's not possible. So 70 volt basically is regulated with a high energy efficiency, is regulated to first to 10 volt and then to around 2 volt because the chips can use 2 volt or 10 volt. It cannot use 70 volt. So that's why you have to go through all these tedious 3 years of work. So you have to design a circuitry that will take 70 volt, very small current, electrical current, and turn it into 10 volt higher current, 2 volt, a little bit higher current, so that your chip can work, your RF transmitter can work. Okay? So basically, that's it. I think I'm done. Okay, this is the conclusion. Basically, what I have shown today, I've shown realization of novel wireless and batteryless microsystem. I praised, basically, I highlighted ultrasonic and optical methods. So in this first study, I used a single LED to power a microsystem, very small, 1 millimeter cube system across 10 centimeter distance. I used it as a temperature sensor. In the second study, I used optically powered millimeter sized wireless and batteryless electromagnetic actuator. And I demonstrated that it can work inside 7 Tesla MRI scanner without causing image artifacts. And in the third study, very quickly, I talked about this triboelectric energy harvesters and the chips, integrated circuits we designed. Okay. Final word, ideas are cheap. You just have to go and do it. So if you just keep talking and talking, if you don't do it, it's meaningless. That's why ideas are cheap. Also, I think we have to start investing money on people. We have done enough building. We have done enough basically to build buildings. We have lots of buildings. We have labs. We have lots of equipment. They are just sitting there, as you can see. But if we invest on people with who has fundamental knowledge, who can smart think, who has stamina and motivation, they'll do great things. Okay. Basically, I want to emphasize this. I think we have to invest money on smart people, hardworking people. Thank you very much for listening. This is the acknowledgements list. So these are all the projects I have acquired so far. Okay. Thank you very much, and I can have your questions.
Thank you very much, Şenol Hocam. This was a great talk. I don't think if you have to leave at 2, we have only a couple of minutes for questions, I guess, right?
Definitely. I can stay for another couple of minutes, I think, before the meeting starts.
Okay. If we now turn off the sharing,
okay,
so we can see the faces, and I can probably.